Okay, this will be the last video lecture on reproduction, and here we're going to focus on parturition and birth. So here's our outline once again, and we are on Roman numeral 5. So we're going to look at the events of parturition, in other words, the events of birth, and then we're going to look at lactation. We know pregnancy lasts approximately 40 weeks. By saying parturition, that means birth, and lactation is the milk production in the mammary glands. And we'll give you more detail on each of these in just a moment. All right, so beginning with the events of parturition, we're going to first start at the end of the pregnancy where the cervix ripens. So when you think about ripening, think about a fruit. When a fruit ripens, it gets softer, right? So like a peach. As the peach ripens, it gets really soft. The cervix gets really soft. And what's happening is that you have enzymatic breakdown of the tissues in that area. These are going to be connective tissues and collagen fibers that are being broken down, and that's why that region gets much softer. It also becomes more flexible, so softer and flexible. Again, think about a fruit that ripens. And then the cervix starts to dilate at the beginning of labor. Uterine contractions begin, and right now it's not clearly understood what initiates uterine contractions, and we're going to talk more about that in a moment. So then the baby's head wedges the cervix open. Remember that the baby is born head first. And then lastly is the expulsion of the placenta, which is also called the afterbirth. We've talked about oxytocin before and how it's synthesized and secreted by the hypothalamus, and then it's stored in the posterior pituitary. And we know that the pressure of the fetus up against the cervix causes this positive feedback loop that causes the release of oxytocin from the posterior pituitary, and then that strengthening those uterine contractions so that birth can take place. So that should be review for you. Okay, now what is the trigger though? However, what's the trigger for those uterine contractions? And this is the process that we're not quite sure about, but this is what researchers think is going on. So they believe that the fetal placenta synthesizes and secretes a CRH, which then causes the fetal ACTH release. This stimulates the adrenal gland to synthesize and secrete DHEA. Let's write that out for you. That's called dehydroepiandrosterone, which is all one word. That's DHEA. So that then, they believe, DHEA is converted to estrogens, which then enter the maternal bloodstream that then initiate birth. As far as lactation goes, estrogen and progesterone inhibit lactation. Prolactin and oxytocin stimulate lactation. So we haven't spent a lot of time talking about prolactin. It's basically one of the last hormones for us to really talk about, and we're going to do that here shortly. If you hear the term colostrum, that's the watery milk that's produced the first few days after birth. It's got a lot of proteins in it, and it does have a lot of antibodies in it. And it does have very few nutrients, but it has a lot of antibodies. If you think about it, especially if it's an animal in the wild, as soon as they're born, you want them to have as many antibodies as they possibly can so that they hit the ground with some sort of immunity. Now, later on, the later milk has more nutrients in it, has some growth factors, hormones, and it still has some antibodies in it as well. But the colostrum is what's loaded with those antibodies. Remember, antibodies are proteins. Let's get into detail then about lactation. So this is going to involve some structures that are associated with the mammary glands called alveoli. So don't confuse these with the alveoli of the lung, okay? Different structures.